Wieland Presley Funeral Home and Crematory, a proud supporter of WQPT, has been serving Quad City families since 1889. Now providing live stream capabilities for viewing your loved one's funeral or memorial service at their chapel in Rock Island.
The sad case of Breasia Terrell and an ongoing fight against child abuse, plus the 4-H on the front line of facing racial injustice in the cities. When you think of the 4-H, you think of kids learning about crops and livestock or participating in fair competitions. But focusing on racial injustice and disparities? More on that a little later. But first, the sad story of Breasia Terrell. The body of the 10-year-old girl missing since last summer has now been found and identified. It ends one chapter and now opens another as police and prosecutors take the case from there. But April is Child Abuse Prevention Month, filled with pinwheels as symbols, but also filled with stories like Breasia's that are so haunting to us all. We talk with Brooke Hendrickx from the Child Abuse Council in the Quad Cities about this case and the thousands of other cases of abuse that go unreported. Brooke, what is the impact of a case like Breasia Terrell?
Unfortunately, the impact of cases like Breasia is that it brings to light that our community is not immune to child abuse. It's not immune to extreme violence against children or just violence in general.
This is a very extreme case, of course. We're talking about a person who tragically died at the hands of an apparent abuser, but that's not the case all the time. I mean, child abuse is going on constantly, and it's a dirty little secret.
Most of the time, yes. And 90% of child abuse cases happen at the hands of someone that the child knows and trusts, which makes it even scarier.
Well, scarier and more insidious in a way, isn't it?
Yes. Yep. A lot of times, though, like you mentioned, child abuse is not, it's not a thought out, planned act. It happens in the heat of the moment due to extreme stress. Stress in homes, stress in the community increases the risk of child abuse.
Is child abuse also, it's a power struggle, is it not? I mean, you have power over somebody.
Yes, not so much as like a domestic violence situation, but yes, yeah, it's showing that you have that power, you have the control. And a lot of times, though, it's more just a matter, just a matter of picking on the vulnerable and knowing that you're more or less vulnerable than that person that you are hurting.
Well, and we know of sexual abuse, and we also know of physical abuse, but there's also that mental abuse that comes along with it. The denigrating of a child is also considered child abuse.
Correct. And actually, emotional abuse is the most common form of child abuse. It's also the hardest to see. And it's most common because it goes along with physical abuse and sexual abuse. That emotional aspect is there in all forms of child abuse.
And we've come through a year of incredible anxiety with the pandemic. Tell me about what the Child Abuse Council has seen over the last 12 months.
We've seen different types of cases, cases that, you know, for instance, parental kidnappings were happening at a little bit higher rate because courts were closed. So custody hearings were canceled or pushed back. We've seen more trauma, not necessarily child abuse, but just trauma on the family that then impacts the children due to financial stress, housing stress. All those uncertainties impact kids, and when kids are removed from the people that they care about, their teachers, their family members, because they're told to isolate, that has an emotional impact as well and can cause trauma for that child. So we've just seen a lot of kids who have anxiety that never had it before, who aren't sure what's happening the next day because of the uncertainty just in the world around them. And that's impacted learning. It's impacted sleep. Just kind of this whole spectrum of things that was a trickle down from the orders that were put in place to keep us safe from a pandemic.
Well, and I also wonder, because children are so sensitive and so vulnerable at the age that they are, that this past year could have a long-lasting impact on children as they develop into young adults and adults.
Absolutely. Yep. Trauma affects the way that our brain develops. And if we're in that fight, flight, or freeze mode for too long, it becomes toxic and actually affects our development, our learning, and can affect how we grow later. There are certain hormones and organs and pieces in our body that don't start growing until after puberty, and those can be affected by early childhood trauma.
So let's talk about that. As a parent who has a young child, you're getting through this year. You see light at the end of the tunnel right now. You're hoping for a good spring, a better summer, perhaps an even better fall and winter as we move on. What are you suggesting for parents to do to help with the emotional well-being of their children?
Number one is just check in, ask how they're feeling. I mean, all those feelings that we feel as adults, the overwhelmingness, the anxiety, the uncertainty, the frustration, kids are feeling those feelings too. They just may not have words for them. So check in with your kids, talk to them, answer questions where you can. Know that you don't have all the answers. It's okay to say, you know what, I'm not sure what this summer's gonna look like, but I sure hope we're able to go out and do more things. And then the other big thing is provide that stability where you can. Stick to schedules where you can. You know, if you have a bedtime routine, stick to it. You know, school may be different, daycare may be different, but if bedtime's the same every night, that helps a child feel safe and secure.
Because some order, some discipline, some, yep. That's really interesting. And perhaps now it's more important than ever?
Oh, yeah. Yep. And I know just for me and my family, I have older children, but anything I could do that was normal, that was a normal routine, I think you could see them become calmer. I felt calmer when I was doing something that seemed normal. So any type of routine and structure you can keep in your day will help your kids feel safe and stable and secure.
Well, April is Child Abuse Prevention Month. People are going to be seeing a lot of pinwheels in
yes.
people's lawns. Explain
yes.
the process of that. What's going on?
Well, pinwheels represent the happy, joyful, safe childhoods that we want and expect for all children. So they're really just a sign of hope and a reminder that kids need protection, and kids are citizens and people as well, and they need to kind of be treated as such as far as protection goes and managing their stress, managing their feelings. All of those things kind of are symbolized in that pinwheel. By the end of next week, I think next week, we'll have planted over 1,700 pinwheels in the community.
If somebody wanted to have some pinwheels in their yard or a company or their organization, how do they go about contacting you?
Well, this year we have maxed out, but
okay.
if they are interested in hosting a pinwheel garden next year, just reach out and let us know and we can add you to the list.
I hate the fact that we tend to talk to you in April.
Yes.
like this is the only month that you can talk about yep. child abuse, and that's so untrue. But I really wonder, sometimes it just seems to be an unbroken cycle.
Yes.
The abuser abuses the abused, who grows up to be an abuser, and the cycle just continues. Am I reading this wrong?
You're not reading it wrong, but that cycle isn't always there. Most children who are abused don't grow up to be abusers. Again, there really is no profile or no... You can't foresee who's going to do that to a child. What we hope is that if a child has been abused, they receive help and support, or they have just one supportive adult in their life that they can look up to as a positive role model, and they can heal and be, you know, have healthy relationships in the future.
Because as you said, first off, child abuse is tough to spot at times, especially
yes.
when it's emotional. So I'd assume the perpetrator is tough to spot as well. I mean, you can't say, oh, this person's going to be a child abuser. That person should get treatment right away.
Correct. What we do see is that children who are exposed to trauma grow up to be adults who are at higher risk of being in traumatic relationships. So in a domestic violence situation, or addicted to drugs or alcohol, or married to an alcoholic or a drug addict, simply because all they know in their life is chaos. Mm-hmm. And they're the type of person who feels calm in that chaos, which is, I guess that may be the cycle that you might have been referring to.
That certainly is part of it, because, I mean, it's just a dysfunction, but the dysfunction becomes normality.
Yep. It's all they know, which is why, so for child abuse, the highest number of cases happen before a child reaches age 5. And that's because at 5 years old, kids start school and they start talking to friends and realizing that what's happening at home isn't normal.
So the question would be, how do you train somebody to spot child abuse? Teachers are on the front line, and of course, yep, Nurses are on the front line. But what about friends?
I think it just comes down to listening. A lot of times we tend to block out what kids are saying and don't really hear what they're telling us. Kids, again, don't always have the words to tell us what's happening to them, but they might say they feel scared around this adult that they're always around, or they might, you know, just feel uncomfortable and not quite know how to show it, so they act out, or behaviors show up that you don't really like when you're at a certain person's house. Listen to kids. Believe them. Kids are not going to lie about abuse. And then act on it. If you feel or think that a child is in danger, make those reporting calls. You know, call DCFS, call DHS. If a child is in extreme danger, call the police. Make those reports and don't be scared to protect the children around you.
Now, throughout this interview, we've had the number for the hotline for child abuse for Iowa and Illinois. And like you said, in a way, that's the extreme. 911, of course, if you're in danger immediately. Mm-hmm. But what does the Child Abuse Council actually provide that perhaps, I don't know, a person may not want to call the hotline, but still want to get some kind of help?
The Child Abuse Council provides education services, so kind of that prevention piece. We also have home visiting services. So if there's a young family or family with young children who maybe just needs a little bit of extra support, we have a Healthy Families program that can help them. We have doulas for expectant parents, so they get support throughout their pregnancy, which reduces stress during pregnancy and then reduces stress on the baby. And then if trauma has already occurred, which honestly right now every child in our community qualifies for our Safe from the Start program because of the pandemic. So we have play therapy that provides kind of that healing, helps kids work through their feelings, and helps parents work through how to address behaviors that show up because of the traumas that a child was exposed to.
And have you seen a lot of people making use of that service?
We've had a few. A lot of it happened when schools were shut down in the spring.
Right.
That was a pretty major impact on a lot of young children. All of a sudden, daycare's closed, preschool's closed, and they lost all contact with their friends. So that initial uncertainty was when we saw the biggest uptick in cases due to just pandemic trauma.
Brooke Hendrickx of the Child Abuse Council, and once again, the Illinois Department of Children and Family Services 24-hour child abuse hotline number is 800-25-ABUSE. And the Iowa hotline, also staffed 24 hours, 7 days a week, is 800-362-2178. In a moment, the 4-H and racial justice. But first, April is in full bloom, and Laura Adams has some great ideas for all of us ready to go out and about.
This is Out and About through April 19th. Join WQPT for a free preview screening of Hemingway at the Bluegrass Drive-In April 2nd at 8, followed by Sharknado. Enjoy an afternoon with family at the Grace Family Church's Scrambled Eggs Community Easter Egg Hunt April 3rd from 2 to 4. It's College Night at the Figgy, hosting a celebration of nearly 100 contemporary and historic American masterpieces. Register for a tour. Take a virtual trip through the 73-year history of Quad City Music Guild with their On With The Show Cabaret, available for streaming March 9th through 18th. Circa 21 presents the Church Basement Ladies in You Smell Barn through May 15th, and for kids, Madagascar, A Musical Adventure, starts April 10th. There's stock car racing at the Davenport Speedway located at Mississippi Valley Fair opening April 2nd, while WQPT is holding a virtual Hemingway-themed trivia night the 9th starting at 7. Quad Cities Interfaith is also holding an online trivia fundraiser as well. The Moline Public Library will be holding a Visit from Ernest Hemingway event the 12th, while Tomfoolery on Tremont with Sam Talent takes place the 14th with shows at 7 and 11. The classic music of John Denver lives on in a Rocky Mountain High experience coming to the Adler April 16th at 8, while the 17th, starting at 10, enjoy the 2021 Geneseo Art Walk. For more information, visit WQPT.org.
Thanks, Laura. The Illinois 4-H leadership says the racial justice demonstration we all saw last summer spurred that organization to intensify its commitment to address existing racism and disparities in its own program. Dr. Lisa Diaz leads the University of Illinois Extension's 4-H program that serves nearly 200,000 children and young adults across the state. And we talked with her from her offices in Champaign. Why is the 4-H concerned in something like racial disparities?
Well, Jim, I think to start, we are a program that, as part of the University of Illinois, has always been committed to serving all the youth across Illinois, across the diverse communities that represent the state. We have a network of about 150 staff doing that work and nearly 20,000 volunteers. So the relevance of this topic to us is really around recognizing that while we have an aspiration to serve all youth, that we're aware that it's a part of a 100 plus year youth organization, that we have done a really good job of serving and tailoring what we offer to a certain population of youth in the state, and that we have a lot of hard work still to do in figuring out how to be as equally relevant and connected to other audiences that we haven't historically served.
The rallies that we saw last summer, the demonstrations for racial justice that you saw last summer, actually made the Illinois 4-H look internally right now to find out if it's doing things correctly.
Absolutely. And this is work that we've been doing for the last several years as we have made resource decisions to intentionally grow our 4-H staff in urban communities, for instance. We have also created new job roles for bicultural, bilingual staff in communities where we have that growing youth population. But we have become increasingly aware that, as I said earlier, if we want to reach our aspiration of inclusion and opportunity for all young people, we need to really stop and do the honest work, the hard work of recognizing the ways in which our program is getting in the way of that aspiration, of the ways that maybe even unintentionally there is exclusion and discrimination against those very audiences that we're seeking to serve. So this is a very relevant and work for us to be doing.
I think it is interesting because when you think of racial issues, you do think of urban areas more than rural areas. You really see it as a major issue of importance for the farm community.
Absolutely. This is not unique to our urban communities. We also know that Illinois, like the whole country, is seeing demographic changes. Our rural communities are not as homogeneous as they might have been at one point. But also, I think from a youth development perspective, our commitment in 4-H is to prepare youth with those life skills that they need to successfully navigate in, contribute to, participate in a world that is connected. And so issues of racism, engaging with people from varied backgrounds are all part of that skill set that we recognize youth, regardless of where they're growing up, are going to need in their future.
What is the reach out as far as, let's say, more black farmers is concerned? I mean, agriculture is such an interesting industry right now. There are so many different aspects to agriculture, as you well know. Mm-hmm. And there's so many opportunities for all types of children of all types of interests.
Yeah, and I don't know that from you know, my lens as a youth development professional, that I can speak as directly to the minority farmers in Illinois and their number and so forth. I certainly have colleagues in the University of Illinois Extension, and then as part of our College of Agriculture, Consumer and Environmental Sciences at the university. That's work and audiences that I know that they are committed to serving. Within 4-H, again, we're always about trying to encourage youth to set goals for themselves. A big part of what we do is exposing them to new career paths, to new areas that they might not have otherwise encountered. And agriculture is certainly one of those. While we know that some of the kids that we serve around the state have grown up in more ag-visible communities or families, there are others who think agriculture is that thing that if I'm not on a plow in the field doesn't relate to me. But we know that food connects us all, that food systems cross urban and rural contexts, and that there are a diverse and growing number of careers connected to the larger agriculture and food systems. So in 4-H, we certainly are working hard to try to connect youth across urban and rural communities to share around those topics like food production and food access that really connect us.
Let's talk about the last year and the pandemic when it comes to 4-H and youth in agriculture. It really was an interesting year, but it also really underlined that farmers and people in our food production industry are indeed essential workers.
Absolutely, absolutely. I think the past year has made us more reflective as a country and as communities, as individuals. There are a lot of things that we took for granted that have been disrupted. And I think there's a lot of positive to that that we can build on in terms of the increased awareness by everyone of the critical role that agriculture plays in all of our lives. And so that's a momentum and a visibility and awareness that I expect will continue to build on in the future.
And when we look at kids and what they missed out in the last year, you think of 4-H, you think of the county fairs, you think of the statewide competition. It was a very tough year last year.
Unquestionably, so many disappointments and challenges. I have to just say, in my role, it has been equally uplifting to see how quickly and consistently the 4-H community has rallied together to give grace to one another, even when there's disappointment, when there's a limbo of not knowing what's coming next and changes, disruptions to traditions that we've always looked forward to in the summer. I am proud to say that in Illinois 4-H, we were able to successfully move 444 of our summer events, those fairs, competitions, exhibit opportunities that our youth have always looked forward to. We were able to successfully adapt those to an online format. And I know in sharing with some of my peers in other states that they didn't have that same opportunity. And so we're really grateful that took a whole community coming together to make that shift. And we're hopeful that we'll be able to start stepping back into face-to-face opportunities in the near future.
I was going to ask you that next, because I, other than looking back, you do have to look forward, and your fingers are crossed for county fairs, because, I mean, fair season is, what, 2-3 months away?
Yeah, absolutely. We're very hopeful, and I know that our staff who are working in each of the 102 counties around the state are actively talking with their county fair boards. We are separate from the fairs. They are a collaborator and partner, but as they're figuring out what fairs will look like, we're also partnering and trying to figure out all of the different scenarios in which we can still make sure that everyone's safe. That's always our number one priority, but that we can look for those opportunities where we might be able to safely gather. It might not look exactly the way it has in the past, and I expect it'll vary from county to county just in terms of the size, the number of youth who would normally be gathering, the facilities, and so forth. But we're very hopeful about this year.
Dr. Lisa Diaz, University of Illinois Extension 4-H Assistant Dean and Director. You can learn more about the 4-H Real Talk video series also by going to the Illinois 4-H website. On the air, on the radio, on the web, on your mobile device, and streaming on your computer. Thanks for taking some time to join us as we talk about the issues on the cities.
Wheeland Presley Funeral Home and Crematory, a proud supporter of WQPT, has been serving Quad City families since 1889. Now providing live stream capabilities for viewing your loved one's funeral or memorial service at their chapel in Rock Island.